Good evening and welcome to our third eCrawl we call Cosmic Clarinet. One of my favorite Summermusik concerts of the past seasons was a collaboration with the Cincinnati Observatory and its astronomer Dean Regas. Dean is not only the astronomer for the Cincinnati Observatory, but was also the co-host of the TV program Stargazers, which airs on over 100 PBS stations around the world. And he also writes astronomy articles for the Cincinnati Enquirer, blogs for the Huffington Post, and is regularly featured on radio as well. If you're online, he also has a really interesting Facebook page, and we are friends on Facebook, and he always reminds me with his posts that the world is much bigger and much more interesting than I think. So, especially in light of the recent headlines made by Comet Neowise, it felt like it's time to reconnect again with Dean and to see what's up out there, or up there, and to connect Dean with Cincinnati Chamber Orchestra's principal clarinet, John Kurokawa. Let's see what out of this world connections between music and universe these two came up with. Please welcome John Kurokawa and Dean Regas.
Hi, my name is John Kurokawa, and I'm principal clarinetist of the Cincinnati Chamber Orchestra. Welcome to this portion of our eFestival Cosmic Clarinet, and we're really thrilled to be joined by Dean Regas of the Cincinnati Observatory.
Oh, John, thanks for coming over here, and this is always great to have music at the observatory, and we're so excited to be part of this.
Great. So, this is a fascinating room. Can you tell us something about this amazing telescope?
Absolutely. So this is our pride and joy. This is the oldest telescope in the United States. It's 175 years old. It had its birthday in April, so we celebrate its 175th birthday. It's 16 feet long, 11 inches in diameter, and made of wood and brass. There is not many scopes like this around the world.
And I have to ask, does it still work?
It still works, absolutely. Everything in here works pretty simply. In fact, if you want to move the telescope, that's how you move it. You can move it with one finger and move it out to the side, aim it up at the stars, and it still works great. So we have people come over and look through the telescope and see the stars, the moon, the planets, all sorts of stuff.
That's incredible. So who designed this, or how many people were involved in designing this?
This was the state-of-the-art from 1845 technology. This was made in Munich, Bavaria, before Germany was even a country. And the manufacturers made these for very wealthy individuals, like the Tsar of Russia. And so this was bought and paid for by the citizens of Cincinnati. It was the first publicly funded scientific institution. And it's so cool to be able to keep up that tradition and share this with the public.
Wow, that's amazing. And this is an incredible acoustic space too. I mean, the sound just seems to ring in here forever. That was part of why I picked that first piece. It's called Fleeting Thought by Bonya Schur, who used to be director of music at Hebrew Union College. And when I play that piece, I just think it's so expansive and needs to be played in a wonderful acoustic space, because that piece makes me think of space. And so I thought that would be a good fit for this portion. Dean, is there anything else you can tell us about the telescope or anything about this room?
Well, I'm so glad to hear the acoustics are good. I feel like I'm echoing and booming in here. And so it's so cool to hear the music echo off the dome. This is a very unique space, as you can tell.
Yes.
We have this hemisphere, this metallic dome over the top of us that opens and closes. So if we want to actually see stuff in the sky, I need to show you how this works, right? Mm-hmm. Well, come on over. I'll show you over. This is how we open up the roof, is over here. So again, this is all low-tech stuff. This is from 1845. And so you just pull on the rope to open it, or unlock it, pull on this rope to open it. And there's our window to the sky, and you just aim the telescope out the window and see whatever you want to see. If you want to look a different direction, then you have to spin the roof.
Okay.
And spinning the roof is over here in this direction. And all you have to do is turn this crank. So you turn this crank and the roof will move. I'm going to try to move it so the sun doesn't get on us. Well, wait. No, that. Yeah, this way. Here we go.
Very cool. It's really interesting to me. I mean, am I correct in assuming that, you know, a modern observatory, it's based on these same principles.
Yeah.
Essentially, yes, just with more modern technology.
Right, right.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Yeah.
Next on our cosmic journey, we're going to play the great jazz standard Fly Me to the Moon by Bart Howard with our music director, Eckhard Proy, at the piano virtually.
Thank you.
So we're standing in front of these really fabulous pictures of the moon, so we thought Fly Me to the Moon would be a perfect fit. So Dean, can you tell us something about these fabulous pictures?
Yeah, these pictures date back to the 1890s. So they were taken at the Paris Observatory, and this was kind of one of their promo pieces, and we bought these way back when. And it really shows these great details because this is the view that we get with our telescopes here. And I've been the astronomer here for 20 years. It is the most popular thing to see in the telescope because you zoom in, you can look in and see the craters of the moon up close, these mountains, these valleys. It looks like a really bad movie set. And so this really highlights what it would look like if you saw them through the telescope. And it's just so cool to see these pictures that are 120 years old, 125 years old, and the moon hasn't changed much.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's amazing to me because as I look at these, I would never guess that these were taken in the 19th century. I mean, they're so sharp and so detailed. It's just incredible to me.
The way that they did that, they took these pictures, this was relatively new technology for the 1890s to get this crisp of a view. Mm-hmm. And so they had this gigantic camera set up on the telescope that would take these big glass plates. And so nowadays you just hold up your phone up to the eyepiece and get a very similar picture to this.
Actually. You can actually do that.
Yep. Yeah. If you get your phone just in the right place, yep, you can get a picture just like that.
Wow. That's amazing. And I know we were just talking before, you also loan telescopes out to members too, yes?
Yes. So if you're a member of the observatory, you can borrow a telescope for a month and you can see the moon, planets, stars. These are some pretty big telescopes too. You can't take the big one here, but you can take one of our portable ones out there. So it's a nice perk of membership.
Yeah, I think that big telescope we just saw probably would be a tough fit for my Prius.
I don't think it would make it. No.
But that's fascinating. Is there anything else you want to tell us about these fabulous pictures or about the moon in general?
Well, so the moon is our closest neighbor in space, but still 240,000 miles away. Mm-hmm. And that's the piece you played is perfect because that's the farthest any human has actually flown to, with Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin making that 3-day trip to the moon and mm-hmm. 3 days back. So perfect setup for this. And that was just awesome for the observatory here to do this right in front of the big moon pictures.
Right. Well, fantastic. Thanks for all the great information about these. These are wonderful. This is the second movement of a piece called Flames by Janusz Kamik. So the piece I played up at the Dome, again, was called Flames by Janusz Kamik, and I picked it because we've had some really interesting solar activity, you know, kind of continuing on with this cosmic theme, you know, the eclipse. And of course, you can probably tell from my nerdy appearance, I love Star Trek, and anything to do with the sun and space is all really, really cool. So now we're out here, and this is a sundial, right? So I see there's compass points. But this doesn't look like any kind of sundial I've ever seen. Can you tell us about it?
It's a very unique sundial, that's for sure. And so that's one of the things we do at the observatory. We need day jobs. So we do look at the sun safely. We have solar filters that we can put on the telescopes to look at the sun safely and see sunspots and solar flares. But this is one of the highlights of a visit to the observatory. Come test out our sundial. Basically, how it works is your shadow is telling you what time it is. So you have to pick a sunny day like we have today, and we use this thing here in the center. This all you have to do is stand on the date, and your shadow will go across the line at the right time. So if I stand on August, wherever we are, mid or late August, my shadow is going across the dial right there between 1:40 and 2 o'clock. So I'd say it's between 1:40 and 1:50. And so that's how we can tell our time just from your shadow. So it's real easy. Just come on over on a sunny day, bring yourself. You can tell what time it is. If you need directions, use your phone. Don't look at the time when you come over. Use your phone to come on over. And yep, stand on the date, and there's your time.
That's really amazing. So I see a dedication plaque in memory of Paul Knorr. Can you tell us a little bit about the history of this sundial and who made it, maybe? And
so my predecessor was Paul Knorr. He was the astronomer before me, and he loved not only sundials, but he loved this figure eight thing. This is called the analemma, and this is how you can correct your sundial. Super geeky stuff. I mean, he was like, so we had to incorporate this into the sundial here, and that's what makes it really unique. Instead of just a stick that can cast your shadow, we thought, let's have more interactive and let people do that as well.
So can you explain how do I do this again? I stand on...
Yeah, so you stand on right about between these two dots, have your heels kind of on that. And then stand up as tall as you can, and yep, there we go, 1:40.
There you go, that's very cool.
So yeah, the outside numbers are a daylight savings time, and then the inside numbers are standard time. So we're in daylight savings on the outside.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Next, we'll perform the song Aquarius from the show Hair, again with Eckert Freud at the piano.
People mistake me for an astrologer all the time. They say, oh, you work at the observatory? I just love astrology. And it makes me cringe up just a little bit because, no, I cannot predict your future, but I can tell you what stars and constellations and planets there are up there. And so that's kind of the big difference, is that astrology is one of those fields that broke away from astronomy, that we, the astronomers were measuring where everything was in the sky. And the zodiac constellations, like Aquarius and Pisces and Taurus and all those, are actual places in the sky that all the planets seem to move through. And so the sun, moon, and planets all go through all those constellations. And so the astronomers would make these charts, and then the astrologers would take that information and then try to predict your future after that. And so I can make the charts, but I can't predict the future.
I'm sorry. I'm going to win the lottery tomorrow or anything like that.
I can't, and especially when the Mercury's in retrograde, I'm completely powerless.
Okay.
Wow. Next, I'm going to be playing a couple of delightful unaccompanied minuets by Bach, transcribed by Jaime Voxman. I picked the music of Bach because in one of the Voyager space probes, they included the music of Bach, so I thought this would be a nice one to include. So I picked the Bach because one of my all-time favorite movies is Star Trek the Motion Picture, and that's how I actually learned about the music of Bach going up with the Voyager space probe. So Dean, can you tell us about some landmark space missions or anything that's going on right now?
Oh yeah, there's so many missions going on currently, but you mentioned the Voyager mission. That one is kind of the epic one that visited almost all the outer planets and also had music attached to it too. So it even had a record that maybe aliens could someday pick up and play. But then we've got the Cassini mission that was circling around the planet Saturn for 13 years and giving some great pictures of the planet and the rings. Now we have the Juno mission that's out at Jupiter. We have a rover that's on its way to Mars, and we have all these satellites viewing the sun. So there's so many missions out there. It's a great way that people can get involved and learn about this stuff, because I think it is inspiring to a lot of people.
That brings us to the end of our program. Thank you so much for joining us. And Dean, thank you so much for partnering with Cincinnati Chamber Orchestra in this great venture. So can you tell us a little bit about the observatory right now? Can people come and visit?
Yeah, so thanks for doing this too, by the way. This has been great having the music echoing around the buildings here. This has just been a pleasure. Thanks, John, for doing this. The observatory is open. We're open on Tuesdays and Thursdays during the daytime between 12 and 4 o'clock. You have to make reservations online. And then we're open on select Friday nights also, and those are reservations done online as well. But the big thing we have are a lot of online programs. So if you want to learn more about space, space travel, space missions, we've got a whole bunch of them on our website, cincinnatiobservatory.org, and it's a great way to learn about astronomy and find your way around the nighttime sky.
That sounds fantastic. Can we find you on social media as well?
Absolutely. We're on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And so if anybody that comes on over, make sure to take your picture with the telescope and with the buildings. Awesome.
That sounds wonderful. Thank you so much again.
My pleasure.
Thank you very much for listening to our program, Cosmic Clarinet. And we're going to end with Henry Mancini's famous tune, Moon River.
Wonderful. A big thank you to our concert sponsors Dan and Lindomis, Gary Shin, and Karen Hartman. Please join us again this Friday for a special event, our fourth eCrawl, with a longtime collaborator of the CCO and phenomenal musician Roger Klug. He will be on one of the BB River boats to perform a show he especially created for us. Rockin' on the River with Roger. This Friday, 7:30 p.m. See you then.